crystallize it. Hold on. This isn't what's happening here now. What's happening now is nothing new. But the form of it, the intensity of it, is new. Okay? It's always been about hegemony, control, and domination of the white supremacist American culture over people of color, particularly the African American. So, when the 60s came, our people asserted themselves through their political consciousness, organizing, with a number of things. The power structure looked at that and said they could not afford to deal with that in the long term. And so they looked for remedies. And one remedy that they discovered, as you talked about Nixon, was the notion of utilizing the prison system as a means of controlling black males and then ultimately black females. Now, what we have to look at is, what are the long-term consequences of this? Number one, it disrupts black families. Number two, it disrupts the black community. Number three, it enriches other communities other than our own. So therefore, we have to question the notion of, is it really about justice, as opposed to, as Richard Pryor would say, just us? Okay, we have to question it. My assertion is that it is about that the prison system, not just in and of itself, but allied with the judicial system, allied with the law enforcement system, allied with the prosecutorial system, all in combination equal an industrial complex relative to jobs, contracts, and communities, small rural communities that have not seen African people on TV or in print to be the beneficiaries of it at the expense of us as a people. But that's one part of it. The other part is that the stigmatization, the letter P, the red letter P, we all remember, I believe it was Hawthorne, the scarlet letter. But the scarlet, the black letter for us is the letter P, that once you have been put in prison, that you must wear for the rest of your life. In other words, just doing time in and of itself is not sufficient. They decided a while ago to move away from the notions of form of individuals going through the system to now punishment and permanent captivity. So that means then a person who was convicted of a felony cannot get housing, cannot get certain loans, cannot go to school, cannot get in certain training programs, cannot in many cases get a job, and if they do, it is locked in on the lower strata. So that means then, when that young person comes out of the penitentiary, okay, what then can they do? Because they're going back into the same family. So therefore, as you alluded to, we need to be vested in discovering remedies, methods, and alternatives, because when these young men and these young brothers come back into our community, and we don't have alternatives for them, then they will perhaps, and I'm not saying this absolutely, will perhaps go back to the old lifestyle that got them in the situation in the first place. But then we cannot just say that that was an independent choice. We have to look at the overall European white supremacist capitalist system that marginalizes us, okay, on a consistent basis. So when you look at this, you can see the results of schools, because we know that many of the prison officials and the planning on the state level looking to drop out rates. That's the piece that's been bandied about. They're saying if you have so many dropouts, then you're going to have so many prisons as a result of that, because you can't function if you don't have the so-called educational credentials. Then how can you get a job, since that's what our emphasis is? So I think that as a moral basis, and I rarely ever use that word, but as a moral basis, we have a duty and obligation to be vested in this, no matter how long it takes, no matter what we have to do. And I think the work that you're doing, we need to document it. Many of our people are still frozen into their head that everybody's in prison is guilty. We know here in Chicago, but that's not necessarily true based on piece that happened with the commander and his torturing suspects to get them to confess. And we know that just us is uneven in its application when it comes to us as a body and as a people. So I just think that the National Black Agenda has a duty and an obligation as organizers as well as ourselves to pursue this issue. The next thing, economically, it makes no sense because you cannot maintain and sustain people at $30,000 to $50,000 to $60,000 to $70,000 or $100,000 depending on what level of jail, what level of prison that you're talking about. You're talking about state money's a little bit small, but if you're talking about beds, you're talking about big dollars that it costs to do what? How be clothed. And watch over each individual inmate in this system. That doesn't even talk about once you get out of the system, you now have to have a parole officer and that type of support system to deal with that. We also have to associate, we also have to raise the question, where does drugs and substances that we have no control over, how does that play a role in the imprisonment? When we specifically talk about the notion of the war on drugs